This is Eric Deters, the Bulldog on Real Talk 1160. As always, we're going to deliver radio superbity to you. Full analysis. You know what? It's kind of funny because I am a talk show host that isn't a sports show, but you'll get the best sports analysis of the basketball games last night from yours truly than you will anybody. Also, my daughter's getting married tonight. Got a special tribute for her, including a good feel-good song. I sat at a rehearsal dinner last night with mother-in-law number one. That is, everybody knows my first wife died of cancer. I remarried. I have a great mother-in-law. And it's the first time forever that I sat and talked at length with mother-in-law number one. And she talked to both me and my wife, and it's hilarious. And I'm going to share with you some stories. She told me, as long as it doesn't reach the, and I'll explain this later, as long as we don't reach Lexington, which I don't know if we do or not. Also, coming up, we have Megan Dills. She is a UK fan, Playboy Playmate, who will be calling in to explain how absolutely despicable the Hoosier fans were the eighth game of the season, and how she was literally stampeded to death, and how tonight UK will stampede the Hoosiers. Also, we will cover everything we normally do, including the political realm as well as the economic realm. We have just absolutely plenty to discuss this morning on this Friday, including, as always, a very funny story. So, TC, are you ready to roll?
I am ready to rumble.
By the power vested in me, we are going to jump right into sports. And the reason being is it's topic number one with the NCAA tournament. The Buckeyes defeated the Bearcats 81-66. Now, I just want to go out right now and just say that I was rooting for the Bearcats as the local team, but I like the Buckeyes too. I am one of probably the few people in town that roots for UK's number one to me, all right? But I also root for both the Bearcats, I root for Xavier, I root for the Buckeyes, and I root for the Hoosiers. But let's face it, you got to make some tough choices. I was rooting for the Bearcats. I thought the Bearcats were on a roll and they were playing gritty. And, of course, they got down 12 points at halftime, came back, were up 4 in the second half, and then the Buckeyes pulled it away. The bottom line is the UC Bearcat program is back. And I'm giving Oracle status to Mick Cronin and the Bearcats for their efforts last night. However, remember what I stated either Monday, I think it was Monday, about I will never, ever, 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 ever understand why coaches sit players with two fouls in the first half in critical games, or three fouls or four fouls in the second half, and what happens? They set Gates. They set Gates for most of the first half with some foul trouble, two fouls, and look what the hell happened. The Buckeyes built up a big lead, and they ended up losing by 15. Well, they built up a 12-point lead at halftime. And you know what, folks? A basket is a basket is a basket. A point is a point. It's like in baseball. You score a lot of runs in the first inning, last inning, it's still a run. Football, same thing. Basketball, same thing. People are like, oh, I've got to save him. I've got to save my best player here going into the late in the game. What good is he if he's on the bench for half to half? And look what happened, TC.
You say hit him early and often, huh?
You hit him early, you hit him often, you keep, especially if it's one and done, you're going home.
Right. Yeah.
The season, and by the way, I want to ask you fans out there, tell me as a fan, you would accept that. If the coach came on and post-game show and said, you know what, this is win and go home or lose and go home, we have to win, I'm keeping my best players on the floor until they're gone. I think every Bearcat fan would say, hey, I don't blame you. Yeah. I don't blame you. Syracuse beats Wisconsin 64-63. Big victory. I mean, people don't realize this, but Syracuse has two really great backup centers that have been backing up Melo, and it's proven the point that they're still winning, which is admirable. You lose your starting center. I mean, I can tell you right now, if UK lost Davis, no, it ain't going to happen. And Wisconsin, of course, is one of those weird teams nobody wants to play. Well coached, slow it down. Syracuse knocks them off. Florida, 68-50. I knew this was going to happen because Florida's a lot better than Murray State. Murray State gave Marquette all that they could handle. And then the big, big upset, but not really too much. Patino got the best of Izzo. Louisville 57, Michigan State 44. This was a low-scoring game, and when Louisville got up by 10, I said, this is over. I mean, if the score is 35-25, are you kidding me? And it's second half, it's kind of like, well, you got a 25% point lead on your score, and their defense was good, and their offense is atrocious. And I believe in the psych. I believe in the psych. It's why I wanted Iowa State to beat Connecticut, because I didn't want Connecticut to have to play University of Kentucky because of their losing last year. It's like UK. Even though Indiana beat UK earlier in the year, did you know that Terrence Jones sat on the bench for almost the entire last 6 minutes of that game? Did you know that Anthony Davis only played 24 minutes in that game? If they let him play, UK's going to whop Indiana tonight at 9:45 on CBS. And being the nice host that I am, we have big screen television at the wedding reception, so everybody coming to the wedding can watch the UK game. Xavier's at Baylor at 7:15 on CBS. Xavier has a couple players that aren't playing. We don't know if they're going to play or not. Wells, don't know. Baylor is hot and cold. All I can tell you is they've got this, and I hate to throw in the word white, but I'm just trying to paint the picture. They got this little white guard who looks like he's 12. And if Xavier can't shut him down, forget about it. Ohio plays North Carolina. This is kind of interesting because Tom Brenneman went to Ohio and Marty Brenneman went to North Carolina. That's kind of funny. They play at 7:47 on TBS. Kansas plays North Carolina State at 10:17 on TBS. And once again, how messed up is it that the NCAA allows these games to be on two different channels instead of staggering them all on one channel? Like, start earlier so you can have them all on CBS or play some on Wednesday. Makes no sense. And you're going to love this, folks. Saturday's Spiral Stakes. Heavy breathing is the favorite. Just think, any right-thinking man will be betting on heavy breathing to win. Don't you agree, TC?
Yeah, that's how they get you, though. They know you'll bet on that one.
Definite betting favorite. Heavy breathing.
And everybody thinks, that's my lucky. That's it.
You know what? You can do lots of neat breathing things with a microphone. You ever thought about that?
Yes, but should you?
No. Chipper Jones, his last year, I didn't realize he's got a .304 lifetime batting average. He's a switch hitter, .454 home runs. He's going to Hall of Fame. And Bengal fans, guess what? Pac-Man Jones, or should we say Adam Jones, is going to stay with the team. I know that makes you happy, doesn't it? Doesn't it make you happy?
Yes.
I sure hope it makes you happy. The guy that's marrying, the justice of the peace, you know, Charlie Ann's getting married by the JP. The guy that's marrying her, TC, Steve Hoffman, is incredible. He's married 28,000 people. 28,000
really?
People.
What is he, a polygamist?
No, but that's a lot.
Oh, he's married them to each other. Oh, I see.
Yeah, TC. Can you imagine that? I tell you, are you going to have a reunion of all the people that you've married? That's injecting a lot of people. I mean, interacting with lots of people.
That is, really.
I mean, that's incredible. Today in history, are you ready for this? Patrick Henry delivered the Give Me Liberty or Give Me Death speech. But you know what? We're going to have to play it. Are we not? We're going to have to play that. 1983, Reagan first proposed the Star Wars, the Strategic Defense Initiative.
SDI.
Yeah, absolutely. Famous birthdays today. Kerry Russell. This is a week birthdays, folks. Kerry Russell, 35. And Shaka Khan. Now, Shaka Khan,
that's pretty
strong. I don't know if you like the music or not, but it doesn't make any difference. Don't you love saying Shaka Khan?
Yeah.
Shaka Khan.
And that big hit of hers, I Feel For You. Trivia question, you know who wrote that song?
Who wrote that song?
Prince. Prince wrote the song on one of his early albums, I think from like 1979.
Do you know, TC, that I saw yesterday that Americans are getting two less hours of sleep a night than they did last 20 years?
Really? I believe it.
See, not only is America going to hell in a handbasket economically and politically, we're taxed. See, the people that are pulling the wagon are having to work so much that they're getting 2 hours less sleep. And less sleep leads to more eating, more obesity. You know what I attribute it to? This is my theory. I'm not kidding you. The computer.
Really? You think so, huh?
Oh, heck yeah. Look how much time people spend at night on the computer playing video games
That's true.
Facebooking and Pinteresting and all that stuff.
Plus, look how many jobs the computer has killed.
It's a job killer. We come back, I'm going to tell you all about my mother-in-law's story that she told last night. Is there anything better than a mother-in-law story?
No.
Radio Superbity on Real Talk 1160.
Remember Bill O'Reilly's Talking Points coming up at 7:28 this morning on Real Talk 1160. And now, back to the Bulldog.
This is the Bulldog, Eric Deters on Real Talk 1160. Listen to rain here. Ladies and gentlemen of the American jury, you know, I call it the way I see it. I discussed yesterday about the irritating phone songs that people have. I'm going to go ahead right now, and I'm sorry, but he's probably sleeping, so he's not listening. The station manager uses one of these terms. Drives me nuts. Is there anything more irritating, guys, than when you get a text or you're being spoken to or a voicemail, and some guy calls you dude, bro, or get this, hombre.
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 The H is silent.
I mean, I can't believe it. Somebody that, hey, dude, hey, hombre, hey, bro. What, you get out of here.
I don't have time to text all those extra
letters.
I'm
not 19. I'm 48 years old. Now, it's okay if you say, hey, that's a pretty cool dude. You don't say, hey, dude. And you also don't. And I use this word like he's a pretty cool cat. But you don't say, hey, bro. Ugh. So, guys, don't text
lame,
me, bro. Don't text me, bro.
You're right. That's lame.
You know, one of the ways I bond with you folks is, you know, I tell you things about my life. So you say, God, that happens to you. Is there anything more embarrassing than when your credit card gets rejected? That's pretty embarrassing. It's kind of like you're defensive. It's like, hey, that shouldn't happen. Or da-da. Sometimes I figured it was about to the limit. Well, my American Express card got rejected when the tuxes were picked up yesterday. And there's absolutely no reason for it. Seriously. I mean, I spend a lot of money every month on my American Express. And you got to pay it off.
Yeah.
And we paid it off. And it rejected. And I had to send it. Chuck out there with the check to take care. I mean, I was ready to kill him, American Express. He tells me that I shouldn't, though. He says the Masons own American Express. Is that true? Do the Masons control American Express?
I don't know. I
thought it was a publicly traded company.
If they do, you better watch what you say.
And, you know, sometimes around Christmas time, like if you're sharing a credit card, I can understand because it's going to hit the limit. But here's the problem with my American Express. True story. There's like six people at my office. Uh-huh. And my wife all have the American Express card.
Same card?
Same card. Ooh. Same account.
Whoa.
I think the wedding is the reason why my American Express. But I'm supposed to have an unlimited limit. I mean, it shouldn't be an issue. Rejection. Even the Bulldog, folks, knows what it's like to have a credit card rejection.
And maybe it's more than just, bad computer skills. Maybe you got somebody upset. In the credit card industry, and they're, I can get him back now.
If I do, I'm going to sue him. All right, my mother-in-law, I'm not going to tell you her age, mother-in-law number one, and I hadn't spoken to her for a while, and I asked her, you know, at the rehearsal dinner, we sat down, and we were just asking her how she was doing everything else, and asked her, you know, if she had dated or anything, because she was a widow. And, she goes, yes, I met somebody, and she starts telling me about this guy's a nice guy, and all these things, you know. And I said, well, how is he? He goes, he died.
Ooh, oh.
She killed him.
What?
He couldn't keep up with her, and the guy died. Do you believe that?
Be careful what you say here.
So anyway, I mean, it was just hilarious. So then I'm saying, well, is there anybody else new? This is a true story. Now, I'm not going to tell your age, But when she was a freshman at University of Kentucky, she dated a Cuban guy, a Cuban dude, named Raul. And she said she liked Raul because he liked to dance. And they dated the whole first year. Well, 60 years later, her sister gets a phone call from Raul looking for her. Wanting to find out whatever happened to her, wanting to hook up with her. Her sister, rather than take down his name and number or say, give me your number and I'll have you call. I'm not going to give you her number. Hangs up on the guy.
What?
So Raul, after 60 years longing to see her again, her own sister guy blocks.
Oh, no.
Guy blocks. Now, she has no idea whatever happened to Raul, what he did. Thinks he was maybe a professor. But I told her, I said, I will find Raul. So Chuck, Bulldog Mafia, has to find Raul for my mother-in-law number one.
It's a moral imperative.
But you might have been 60 years later trying to find your freshman girlfriend. Now, by the way, mother-in-law number one's a trip, man.
Now watch, if they connect, there'll be a great story on Sunday morning.
I'll have them in on the radio show.
Yeah, you know?
It'll be a national talk show, hooking up after 60 years.
That'd be amazing.
Raul, the Cuban. I love it.
And your sister blocks.
Her sister blocks.
Her sister, yeah.
Oh, man, they did the same joke. You know, it's a good that I got a backup joke. Well, I got some material that I can use the backup joke. They redid the same back. They redid a joke. God, I hate when they redo a joke. Got a great history story for you, folks. This is president, by the way, was one of the top five worst presidents. I place him right there with Buchanan, Carter, under Obama, and Bush number two. In 1853, Franklin Pierce, just weeks before the first family was scheduled to move to Washington, tragedy struck. The 11-year-old son, Benny, died in a train wreck in Andover, Massachusetts. He was caught under a train car and crushed to death while Franklin and Jane Pierce watched helplessly. I mean, this was terrible. They watched their son die. Jane Pierce was so stricken with grief, she was unable to act as first lady for nearly 2 years. Jane blamed Franklin for the Pierce's family's uprooting from New Hampshire home and for Benny's death. By the way, this is a fact. It's hard for a marriage to survive the death of a child. Mrs. Pierce believed that their family in general and President Pierce in particular were being punished by God. Further evidence of the Lord's apparent wrath came when the sudden unexpected death of Pierce's close friend, New Hampshire Senator Charles Atherton, an alleged alcoholic, who didn't make it to the inauguration. The grieving president turned to the bottle to deaden the pain of Benny's loss and death and his wife's bitterness. Soon, critics began to claim that President Pierce was a chronic alcoholic, incapable of performing his duties to the nation. But despite his affection for whiskey and much publicized drinking binges, which included his being slapped with what amounted to a DUI for running over an old woman in the presidential carriage, he was cited. By the way, his biggest failure was the compromise of 1850. Franklin Pierce managed the affairs of the United States until he left office in 1857. During the final days of his presidency, he was asked about his future. He replied, "There's nothing left but to get drunk." He's number five on my all-time worst list.
Number five.
James Buchanan is number four. Jimmy Carter is third. George Bush, two, is second. And Barack Obama is number one. Is that a shocker?
We're number one.
Oh, too sexy. We come back. I think we have the two fat guys from Ace Hardware.
Oh, yeah.
Radio Superbity on Real Talk 1160. Eric Deters, the Bulldog, on Real Talk 1160. It's been a long time ago. The eighth game of the season for the University of Kentucky Wildcats in Indiana. When on the Hoosiers' home court, UK lost by a point on a last-second shot. And we want revenge. And I think I know somebody else that wants revenge. Megan Dills. And she's on now to tell her story. Megan, welcome to Real Talk 1160.
Good morning.
Megan, first, it's my understanding that you are a model, and you once you were part of a Playboy edition that had it focused on the girls of the SEC, and you were from University of Kentucky. Is that correct?
That was my first issue of Playboy. You're correct.
Have you been in it again?
Yes.
All right.
I went on the next year to represent UK in a college girls issue. So I've been with Playboy ever since 2007, doing different things here and there.
Now, everybody's going to want to know to look you up and Google you. It's Megan Dills, D-I-L-L-S, correct?
That's correct.
Will you tell Megan Dills, the ladies and gentlemen of the American jury, what happened to you when you attended the Indiana-Kentucky game way back when?
Okay, so I went to the Indiana-Kentucky game. I go to a lot of games. I'm a huge Kentucky fan. And, you know, it was incredibly awful that day. It was an awful day for
UK was playing bad. UK was playing bad.
There, you know, we didn't play well that game. And, you know, we kind of handed it over to them. So I was there, and the IU fans got a little out of control and rushed the court. And I got knocked down several stairs and ended up with a sprained ankle, some torn tendons and ligaments. And I actually missed a shoot with a Playboy photographer in Indianapolis that I had scheduled for that coming weekend.
So they stampeded you.
Yeah, I mean, in a sense, they stampeded everyone, you know. They stampeded themselves and, you know, had our, you know, Darius Miller.
Darius Miller was on the floor. He got stampeded.
Yeah. So, and, you know, I know a lot of those guys, you know, personally. They're friends of mine. Not just are they basketball players for UK, which makes it bad enough, but they're friends of mine, and I don't appreciate that. And, you know, I don't think anyone does.
So, what are you hoping for tonight at 9:45? I mean, I have predicted this, Megan, because I'm a big UK fan, and the reality of it is that Anthony Davis only played 24 minutes that day in foul trouble. Terrence Jones set for nearly the last 6 minutes because he was in Calipari's doghouse. Teague did not play well. It was the only 8th game for all these freshmen. I think Kentucky is so much better than they were when they just played them. Indiana might be a little better, but it doesn't make any difference. Furthermore, we're playing in Atlanta in an SEC forum that Kentucky is used to and Indiana is not. And barring an injury, barring foul trouble, which sometimes can happen, or barring Indiana just rains down threes that go in left and right, I think Kentucky's going to mop the floor with them. What do you think?
We're the better team by far. I mean, you said it. You know, you said everything I could say. We have a team that is structured and that is that seems like a seasoned team, even though they're young. And we have Davis and we have Jones and Duron Lamb that are sophomores, and then we have Michael Cade Gilchrist, it's a freshman, and Teague, it's a freshman. We're going to handle them tonight. I mean, it's not going to be pretty. And these guys hate that ESPN commercial. I know it firsthand. It's not something that they took lightly. This loss to IU I think it impacted them, you know, bigger than them losing our SEC conference.
It ruined that perfect season. And I thought it was ironic because the last team to go undefeated in the NCAA and win a national championship was Indiana. So when they were playing for that Vanderbilt game in the SEC tournament, would have meant more. I can tell you this. I've always said this about the kind of players that Calipari are recruiting. When you get McDonald's All-American type players and the best players in the country, they are used to the limelight at an early stage. They're used to the limelight in middle school. They're used to the limelight in high school. They're used to the limelight. So this is something that's not foreign to them. But the fact that they do have a little bit of experience with Miller and Jones and Duran Lamb, but let me tell you something. They have like the perfect team for the following reasons. They have the number one player in the country in the middle, so they got the big man. They got they got a great power forward. They got a great shooting forward and defensive player in Gilchrist. They got a great point guard in Teague, and they got a great shooting guard in Lamb. And then they've got bench players. Miller comes off, great play. Wiltshire can come in and hit a three, and Vargas can give you a few minutes. So everybody talks about their lack of depth. That's baloney. They can go 8 deep without missing anything, and furthermore, they've played so much, they don't get tired. That's another advantage, right? I think, Megan, is when you're playing a team all year long and you're playing like 5 and 6 guys, they don't get tired.
Yeah, this is something I was asked at the, I was at the in Louisville at the Yum Center just this past weekend. And someone, you know, there was these guys in there from Michigan, and they'd never been to a Kentucky game. They just happened to be in and bought tickets and said, you know, they seen the tickets and said, okay, we'll go. And they were just like, you know, why is this guy playing these same players? What if one of them gets hurt? He's only playing a five-man team. And I said, no, he plays we're really a six-man team. When you throw, you know, we have Darius, and Darius is, I don't think that Darius is our sixth man by any means, but I think that we, you know, he's always who we fall back on. But even if there was an injury, you're right. We can pull in Kyle and have him hit threes. Or, you know, and he's a good, you know, he's a little slower than the rest of the guys, but he gets it done.
He's gotten better. He's gotten better on the defensive side, blocking shots and everything else.
You know, and then, I mean, when you take a combination of, you have Terrence Jones who dunks all night on them, and then you've got Davis who does the same. And with the two of them, you know, and Terrence doesn't get enough credit for all the blocks that he does during the game. Anthony may have, you know, broken the record and all that, whatnot, but, you know, Jones has seen that and said, let me have a little bit of that. You know, let me get a piece of that action.
He's
knocking them down.
Rick Pitino used to say that to win a national championship, you probably need three NBA, unless you've got some special circumstance, three NBA players. UK has six.
Right. We do. You're going to see, I mean, of them are going.
Megan, what's going on with your modeling career? Anything you want to promote?
You know, I still do things. I have an actual day job. So I do things, and I do travel a lot in the summer and do things for Playboy Golf. And I always think that, you know, kind of look out for us. We're here, there, and everywhere. I have a charity foundation for my dad who passed away from cancer.
Cancer sucks.
Mm-hmm, it does. And my brother right now is going through, he just finished his first round of radiation and chemo, and he's all done with that. So he has the same cancer that my dad passed away with, and that's squamous cell carcinoma, and it's a very aggressive oral cancer. So for those of you who smoke out there, that's what I want to say to you. You know, look, it does happen. You can get cancer from it, and just give to the American Cancer Society as much as you can, you know.
What if somebody, do you have a fan page? Do you have a Twitter account? Do you have anything anybody wants to follow you?
Yeah, you can just follow me at Megan Dills. I don't do the whole fan page, but you can look me up on Twitter or Facebook. And I'll talk to you. You know, we can talk whatever. Just don't come at my page with any kind of nonsense about Kentucky not being the best team, because I'll block you, I'll remove you, and I'll come back with something, you know.
I like that, Megan, fighting for the home team. Well, God bless you, Megan, and we'll have you on again, okay?
Yeah, thanks. You have a good day, and go UK.
UK, go Wildcat. You know, Kentucky's one of those teams, TC, just like any good team. You either love them or you hate them.
Yeah.
It's like Duke. We hate Duke. It's like the Cowboys. You either love them or you hate them.
We love them.
And if you know, it's like anything. If your team is the front runner, it's great. But if your team's not the front runner, you're always rooting for the underdog. I mean, I don't care who plays North Carolina or Duke. I'm rooting for them. And there's people like that. Like a lot of my fans, Bulldog Nation member Justin just told me he hates Kentucky. Well, you know what? You're either going to love them or hate them. So there's going to be a lot of people rooting for Indiana, you know, including all the Hoosiers.
I got a funny story about a guy, a friend of mine. He runs a newspaper down in Grant County. We're going to lunch. Now, you talk about a UK fan.
Right.
Okay? We're walking to lunch one day. We were walking past these kids, you know, older boy and a younger boy, little brother, whatever, tossing the football. Neighborhood dog breaks loose and goes after the younger boy, starts to attack him, okay? The older boy takes his football, throws it at this dog, reaches over, it's like a pit bull, grabs this dog from this kid and twists its neck and kills it, saves his little brother. My friend runs over and says, you're going to be the front page of the newspaper tomorrow. You know, brave teen, you know, brave UK fan saves brother from vicious animal. And the kid says, that's great, mister, but I'm not a UK fan. I'm a Louisville Cardinal fan. So he rewrites the headline, unruly teen kills family pet. Now that's a UK fan for you.
And there's a lot of them out there.
Oh, yeah.
There's a lot of them out there.
Bleeding blue.
But I can tell you right now, I think, you know, the thing about sports, though, is I mean, UK can win the national championship. But as we all know in sports, man, anything can happen. I think in football, the best team is more likely to win than not because of the nature of the game. In basketball, foul trouble and a cold night shooting.
Too many variables.
There's variables that you just never know.
That's a good point.
When we come back, more Radio Superbity and the Two Angry Guys are back on.
Fat guys.
Two fat guys.
That's why they're angry.
The two fat angry guys on Real Talk 1160.
Remember to get back in the garden with Denny McEwen tomorrow morning from 8 to 10, followed by the Two Fat Guys Hardware Show on Real Talk 1160. And now, back to the Bulldog.
All right, we got the Two Fat Guys from Ace Hardware coming up. According to Bob from Aurora, they're going to promote their new book called Two Fat Guys Greenwater Cookbook, which can be found at Ace Hardware Plumbing Sections. Apparently, you can make some great meals such as green water salami and lard casserole, green water Limburger cheese chicken, and green water fat guys chili and Cheeto surprise. So we'll see how the book sales are going. How you guys doing? Thanks for being flexible this morning.
We're great. How are you, Bulldog?
We're doing great. What's going on at Ace Hardware? And do you want to make a friendly wager about your Hoosiers losing to the Kentucky Wildcats?
We want 10 points.
I'll give you 10 points.
You will?
I'll give you 10 points. What are we going to bet?
If we lose, we come on your show in a few weeks. And if you lose, you go to one of the Ace Hardwares and be the greeter for an hour or two.
Deal.
All right, we're in.
Deal. I don't mind greeting people. Hi, welcome to Ace Hardware. Pick up your green water. It's on aisle number 5, shelf number 4.
Perfect. And pick up your Bulldog's product there, the cleaning product too, huh?
Is it true what happened to you, Rick, at the hotel you were staying in the other day on that trip?
Well, which part?
I heard the lady at the registration that you had asked the lady at the registration that you hoped that the porn channel in your room is disabled, and she told you, no, it's regular porn, you sick SOB.
How'd you know? Were you there?
I don't know. I heard that was going around, man. That's all I'm just saying.
It happens every time. Yeah, but he tried to raccoon lovemaking the other night. After he got done making sweet love to his wife, he went in the kitchen and kicked over the trash can.
Is it true what the police told you about your wife?
What's that?
I heard that your wife's been missing for a week, Rick, and that they told you to prepare for the worst, so you had to go to the thrift shop and get all her clothes back.
You and Smokey been talking all morning. Man, it's beat up Rick Day. I got it. That
one was meant for Smokey.
Now, Bulldog, what do you call a lady that can clean with one hand and do the dishes with the other hand?
A good woman.
Mop with her left foot and sweep with her right foot.
An impossible woman.
A Swiss Army wife.
That's good. What are you promoting at Ace Hardware this week?
We got a three-quarter paint again.
But I still can't believe you're making money giving away paint. I guess it's like a loss leader, like a convenience store.
Yeah, who said we're making money?
You still got salt. You still got salt. Can you use salt in a yard for anything, like to kill the grass you want to kill?
If you want to kill it, yep. You can do that, and if you don't like your neighbor, you can fertilize his lawn with some ice melt. But here's what we got. We got the four-step that's only at Ace, and it's the Scott's program. You want to get your pre-emergent down now. Marymount, the new Ace store in Marymount's open. Newport's going to be open in a week or two. And bugs, man, bugs are bad. You need to get on them right now, and we got everything to help.
What do you have to help?
We've got, in particular, it's the Ortho Home Defense. The great thing about that is after you put it down, as soon as it dries, it's inert, and it won't hurt any pets or kids.
Wow, that's good. What are you going to talk about on your radio show tomorrow at 10 o'clock?
Man, we got a lot of fun going on. We've got a guy that actually did the Iditarod. The Iditarod was completed last week.
I did that once.
We got him on the show, and he's telling us all about it. And Rick made a lot of disparaging remarks about you.
Well, you know,
I did not. Oh, Smokey.
I want to let you know that I don't mind making disparage as long as you get the name right, Bulldog.
Oh, yeah. Well, I think Rick called you Ham Dog or something like that.
No, I didn't. It was Bulldog. I know his name.
Did you hear Ron Paul's trying to steal my name to be his Secret Service name? He wants to be called Bulldog. True story. But, of course, he doesn't have enough votes to even get Secret Service. How pathetic is that, that you don't get Secret Service and Santorum does?
Oh.
That's when you know it's time to quit.
Doing.
Well, guys, what are your final thoughts today? Tell the ladies and gentlemen, the American jury, anything you'd like.
Well, it's better to have it and not need it than to need it and not have it. So get into your Ace Hardware store, tell them the two fat guys sent you, and there's a free bag of popcorn on us waiting for you.
All right, guys. Great to have you on as always, the
free
two fat guys.
Free popcorn and paint.
Free popcorn and paint. How do you beat that?
Not a bad deal.
Not a bad. Free popcorn. All right, now, Sarah put the repeat joke in, so I apologize to that in the blog and newsletter. But somebody sent me, a Bulldog Nation member sent this to me. Everybody knows that famous saying, Nyoka Johnson, the one that's told me that if you give a person a fish, you feed them for the day, and you teach them how to fish, you feed them for a lifetime. Well, this is what somebody sent me. Give a man a fish, and he eats for a day. Give a man a welfare check, a free cell phone, free monthly minutes, food stamps, Section 8 housing, and some Air Jordans, and he votes Democrat for a lifetime. That's terrible. But it might be true, TC. What do you think? I got to ask you a question. Do you think, that's a really good question. How many people do you, see, because rich people, there's some liberal rich people who are Democrats, and there's some rich people that are Republican. I mean, rich people are both ways. Yes. How many Republicans do you think you could find in a Section 8 housing project? Everybody's on full government assistance. How many of those people do you think vote Republican? I'll bet you none.
I don't know. I'm wondering how many people would vote, period.
You know, that's a great point. I would bet that maybe a few do because of the issues like they're really patriotic. So they want to vote Republican, strong defense, that kind of thing.
Uh-huh.
But you know what? I agree with you. Like the spring break people that we talked about yesterday that Bill O'Reilly interviewed, those kids aren't voting. There's no way they're going to vote.
Right, right.
When we come back from this break, how much longer till we get the break, buddy?
We have just under 3 minutes.
Well, heck, let's do pop culture now.
You want to do it?
We'll do pop culture now.
We're going to do it.
Whitney Houston, according to the coroner, drowned. However, they don't know if she had heart failure. In her system was cocaine, marijuana, Xanax, Flexerol, and Benadryl.
Really?
Yep. That's a lot of stuff.
I just saw something on, I think it was TMZ, said that she had premonitions of death. I've been quoting the Bible a lot lately, singing spirituals.
Don't we all have premonitions of death?
No, I don't. I'm not having anything like that.
Kim Kardashian. Now, I'm not a big fan. However, someone threw white powder on her, all over her. Bulldog note, that makes me mad. It's mean, it's cruel.
Why?
And I say kick their butt. I don't know. They just did it. You know, like people that throw pies in Bill Gates' face and stuff like that. I mean, that's just mean.
Right, right.
It's just plain, flat-out mean.
Why would you do something like that?
Kim Kardashian, if you want something taken care of, call the Bulldog Mafia. We got your back. Obviously, you need more security. Can you imagine if I said, hey, Chuck, we got a special detail. We're going to do the security for Kim Kardashian. How quick do you think it would be for Chuck to say, I'm off to L.A. Thank you very much.
No, see, his girlfriend, Heather Locklear, wouldn't let him go.
That's a good point.
That's
Heather
would
Locklear
happen.
Would probably say, Chuck, you're not going to guard Kim Kardashian.
Right, and he'll be stuck here.
How cool is it to be the godfather with muscle of a mom? I tell you, I enjoy the position.
Life is good.
People don't mess with you. They know Chuck will knock on their door.
That's right.
Hunger Games. I was unfamiliar with the book series, you know, because I said, who wants to watch a movie about kids? But then I've learned, a Bulldog Nation member educated me, that it really focuses on how terrible big totalitarian government is and how, like, one generation can wreck the world for the later generation.
Yeah, I can
good
see
theme
that.
Good theme in there.
Yeah, very good.
We need to be careful. When we come back, I'm going to weigh in on the political world. I know you look forward to this every day, folks. The Bulldog on Real Talk 1160. Eric Deters, the Bulldog on Real Talk 1160. A few news items. First of all, Mohamed Merah jumped out a window shooting, and they shot him. The French terrorist is now dead. The standoff is over. Robert Bales, the Afghan Marine, well, he's an American Marine in Afghanistan, now faces 17 murder counts, as he should. And in Florida, folks, let me tell you something. The Stand Your Ground law has absolutely nothing to do with the Trevor Martin. I'm tired of watching cable news talk about the Stand Your Ground law. He called the 911 caller, "Stand your ground, my butt." He was following the kid, and they told him to stop.
Yeah.
Stand my ground, my butt. One of Bulldog Nation members has a theory that the kid might have turned around and says, "What the hell are you doing following me?" An altercation ensued where he's getting the hell beat out of him, so he had to pull his gun out.
Could be. Could be.
But give me a break. Stand your ground. He ain't standing your ground. He's following the guy.
I mean, the guy did his job. You called 911, let it go. They'll handle it from here.
Exactly. And again, it is, in my opinion, in fact, I posted on Facebook yesterday when I commented that this is a typical example of these citizen watch groups where they have the power. I can just look at that Hernandez guy, and I bet you he's telling his friends, "Yeah, man, I'm a captain of the citizen's watch," like he's some semi-cop or something. And somebody said, "Who watched them?" And they said, "The fake police chief."
You know, Phil Hendry, early morning before America's Morning News, every now and then he has this recurring character, and this guy's like the head of his neighborhood citizens watch group, and it's the funniest thing because he's like a mall cop. Yeah, I mean, really.
Part of humor is that there's some truth to it. Remember those Citizens on Patrol movies?
Yeah.
Those comedies?
Yeah.
And it's the truth. You know, you got these citizens on patrol.
They're vigilantes.
Helping out the cops.
Now, I have a prediction, and I hate to say this, but did you see the swarms of people that gathered in Florida and also in New York for this? If this guy does, I mean, first of all, he hasn't been arrested yet. And if there's no conviction, you remember Rodney
chief,
King?
The police chief is...
Stepped down.
Stepped down.
Yeah. You remember the Rodney King, the riots that happened after that? Oh, my gosh. And you've got an innocent teen. I mean, the kid was, you know, and he was on... They have a witness because he was on his cell phone with a friend of his just a few minutes before this all happened. So, man.
You know, unfortunately, for those people that are upset, you've got to let the process play it out. But I hope Hernandez gets what's coming to him.
Yeah.
Now, maybe there's something we don't know about, but, man, it smells to high heaven.
Right.
Smells to high heaven. On the political front, Barack Obama. How do you like this, folks? Barack Obama, he's blaming Congress and claims he wants that short section from Oklahoma to New Orleans of the Keystone Pipeline to be fast-tracked. And the sole reason for this move is the price of gasoline. There is nobody will ever tell me that he didn't think to himself, man, if I fly out to Oklahoma, have this press conference, and blame Congress, then maybe this will help the price of gas go down. Ladies and gentlemen of the American jury, how hypocritical is it for him to support part of the pipeline from Oklahoma to New Orleans instead of the entire pipeline? If the pipeline is a good thing, it's a good thing. And ladies and gentlemen, the American jury, remember when all of these, the ideas of shovel-ready projects came out and let's invest money in our infrastructure, and he came here to Cincinnati and said, we've got to rebuild this Brent Spence Bridge and all this. And one of the things that I said that if I was president, I would just tell my EPA, I would tell the Army Corps of Engineers, I would tell my transportation cabinet, I said, hey, we're going to speed up this permit process. We're not going to go through all these hoops. Isn't it funny that miraculously, for this section of the Keystone Pipeline, Barack Obama has now said, I've told everybody in my administration, why don't they do that on all these projects? They're going to create jobs. It proves that where there's a will, there's a way. And he can do it if he wants to do it. But he does this bizarre, like, okay, you for it, you against it. He's halfway for it. I mean, it's incredible. I don't know if this is a correct analogy or not, but I saw this yesterday. You know, somebody, you know, like a pedophile, is there anything worse than a pedophile? And somebody makes the argument, well, you can say a lot of bad things about a pedophile, but at least they drive slow through school zones. A sick joke. And I'm thinking to myself, TC just dropped his head. I'm thinking to myself, you know, that is an extreme example, though, of it's kind of like you're trying to spin something really bad to try to make it good. That's an extreme example. Well, Barack Obama has opposed this thing. Oh, and how about this? One of the reasons why he opposed it. Now, there's been studies and tests about this for years. When Congress passed the bill and basically forced him to make the decision in 90 days, he says, well, we can't get this done. You know, it's Republicans' fault that they're rushing us. It's been studied for years, folks. Here's some more hypocrisy. Did you hear what he said? He said, it's Congress's fault. They didn't want to listen to the experts, the engineers, and the experts in this field, and the scientists, Okay, Mr. President, how come you don't listen to the experts and the scientists in healthcare, in banking, on Dodd-Frank, in drilling offshore, so forth and so on? In other words, he plays the, well, I'm listening to the experts cards when it suits him. It's almost as bad as Mitt Romney going down to the South and saying, hey, I eat some cheesy grits. How y'all doing? Barack Obama putting on a leather jacket or a suede jacket without a tie and going to Oklahoma like he's a wildcat oil man is a joke. Obama the wildcatter. You know what? He would pinch his hands and have to go to the hospital after 15 minutes on the job. Can you picture Barack Obama working on an oil rig, TC?
No.
Isn't going to happen. Oh, it makes me crazy. Oh, and then Solyndra. He says, it's not my fault. It's not my fault at all. It's Congress and China's fault. Are you kidding me? This guy named Chow, his energy secretary, is the one to blame. I'm just getting on a roll here, folks. Louisiana coming up is the vote. Can Romney win it? No. It'll be Santorum and Newt. But let me tell you something. My next tirade that I'm going to go on, I'm shifting from Obama, is towards Santorum and Newt Gingrich. There have been various times during the GOP primary that I've defended each candidate. And everybody knows I was a Herman Cain man before anybody else was. But I can't defend them any longer. And by the way, they are proving. See, everybody that runs for president, you have to run for president. And back in the old days, like Washington, Jefferson, Jackson, it was really important that you didn't act like you wanted the job, that you were recruited for the job, that you were doing it for the betterment of the country. And when you can project, and of course Romney is claiming that, he's saying, hey, I know business, I can help create jobs, I'm going to do this for the betterment of America. Well, what Santorum and Gingrich have done is they've managed to shift away from the limelight of their cause to making it about them. Do you realize that this is true? To get the number of delegates he needs, the 1,149, I think it is, or 44, you know what? He has to win 75% of the remaining delegates. It's not going to happen. Santorum and Newt Gingrich cannot win the nomination. When you realize you can't win the nomination, it is time to set aside your ego and get the hell out of the race. It has become about them and not the cause. Now, let me give you an example of an exception. Ron Paul. Everybody knows Ron Paul wasn't going to win. Ron Paul, it really is about his cause. I mean, it's about he doesn't want war. He doesn't want government interference. He's about liberty. It always has been, always will be about his cause. It's genuine and it's true. Everybody knows about it. So I don't care if Ron Paul stays in. I really don't. Because Ron Paul, everybody knows, is campaigning for the cause. What cause is Rick Santorum and Newt Gingrich campaigning for that isn't represented by Mitt Romney? What causes the gasoline prices? You know, that which is Newt Gingrich's call. Guess what? Romney already is against those two. And then you got Santorum yesterday saying, what a big mistake. Because both Romney and Newt jumped all over him. Said, well, if you elect Romney, you might as well just keep Obama. Uh-oh. That is a big mistake. Republicans, Santorum now prefers Obama over Romney. See ya, Rick. Overstay your welcome like a bad uncle that comes to stay at your house at Christmas and won't leave. This is the Bulldog slow riding on Real Talk 1160.
And now back to the Bulldog.
This is Eric Deters, the Bulldog on Real Talk 1160. Remember, you can email me at eric@ericdeters.com. You can follow me on Twitter under Bull Law with three L's. Also, Facebook, Eric Deters. Text me at 859-250-2527. My suspension in Kentucky, I think, is now under 30 days. How do you like that? We're over halfway through. FedEx, their forecast is a recession in Europe and a weak recovery. By the way, Federal Express is a great economic indicator because of the nature of their business, which is hauling packages for business. Stocks, how do you like this? The stocks drop because China has issues. How crazy is that? See, China's not perfect. They have their own problems. And they're our biggest creditor, and they have problems. I tell you right now, I still say, though, if somebody else gets elected president, and the Republicans can take the Senate, we could have an economic boom. I really do believe that. I really do think we can have an economic boom if that happens. I want to congratulate and give good blessings very publicly to my daughter, Charlie Ann, and Chad Fuller are getting married tonight. This is the first child of mine that is getting married. Charlie Ann's a great daughter, sister, mother, and friend. Chad's a fine young man who loves her and her daughter. You know, folks, to love another person's child is very, very special, and he does. And they both work hard. You know, they're young. They're too darn young to be getting married, but the reality of it is my grandpa Deters got married when he was 18, and grandma was 17 or 16, and it lasted over 60 years. And by the way, this is funny to think about. This is so funny. Clemens Bud Deters, my grandpa, met my grandma Deters when she caused him to wreck his bike, and he got mad at her. They met in other words, he apparently cussed her out. Well, ooh. Something must have changed, and they ended up becoming an item. And this is hilarious to think about because he was my grandpa. So I see my grandpa just as my grandpa, this gray-haired, distinguished man. Allegedly and apparently, Sedora's mom and dad hated my grandpa. And it's kind of weird to think about your grandpa as an 18-year-old whippersnapper trying to take somebody's daughter away from him, and they didn't like him. And that marriage lasted over 60 years. And Chad, another good thing about Chad is every woman's dream, he's a handyman. My apologies to my wife. I mean, he's a handyman. But I'm going to publicly give them an Irish blessing. And, you know, I love this. May the road rise to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. The rains fall soft upon your fields, and until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. A public Irish blessing from Dad. Now, this is funny. Charlie Ann got too much Irish blood in her. She was a whippersnapper. When she was in grade school, I remember getting called by the teacher. She crawled underneath. Now, she's like in the third grade. She crawled underneath the bathroom stalls in the girls' bathroom and locked all the doors and crawled back out. Now, I think it's kind of funny, you know. She got detention for that, and I thought it was kind of funny. And then in high school, she tackled the Campbell County Camel. She tackled the Campbell County Camel at a football game, and the Campbell County police and the Campbell County principal were looking for her. And she hid in the Simon Kenton crowd, and they escaped her.
What do the animal rights people say about this?
I don't know. But it's legendary. At senior night, all the kids graduating, like all the fellow cheerleaders,
yeah,
like they say, what's your favorite moment? My favorite moment was when Charlie Ann tackled the Campbell County camel. She got suspended from cheerleading, and she says it was worth it. Tell me she's not a chip off the old block.
Now did she, she
see,
is.
I got. See, I'm not the first member of my family to get suspended from something.
My daughter got suspended
from cheerleading.
Now that, but you still did it first.
What did I get suspended from?
No, I don't. You said you're not the first member of your family. She's younger than you. So whatever she did it after you'd already done it.
No, she had to serve her cheerleading suspension 3 or 4 years ago.
You didn't get suspended for anything in high school?
No, I never did. I never did.
Nothing went on your permanent record?
No, I never did. I was mischievous, but I would never cross that line to where I got in real trouble. Ladies and gentlemen, the American jury. How much time? We got enough time for this?
Yeah, we got enough time for which?
This what we got, this clip.
Oh,
ladies,
yeah.
This is great. Bulldog Nation member Ryan told me. He said, it's like Gomer Pyle's citizen's arrest. And I started laughing because it is. Remember this? This is a citizens group.
It's my duty to call you on it. You're supposed to be setting examples for the rest of us.
So Gomer should shoot him now, right?
Now, Gomer,
this is hilarious.
This little black and white baby here is a real emergency vehicle. Now, why don't you just stop trying to get even?
But you weren't on no emergency call.
Gosh, you weren't on no.
The whole crowd, the mob.
You made a mistake, Deputy.
The Mayberry
now,
mob.
Now, watch yourself,
I'll take you. The Mayberry police officer.
You got to be kidding.
You hear that, folks? There are two sets of laws. One for the police and one for the ordinary citizen.
Here, here. There.
You tell him, Gomer.
Yeah.
Here comes Andy.
Boob here.
Boob. Well, that's an insult in the face of the public. There ought to be another law that covers that.
Oh, you can't be insulting people in public like that. You're supposed to set an example.
That's right.
That's what I say.
What happened? Oh, nutsy here, come running after me screaming, citizens arrest!
This is the problem with citizens groups.
He made an illegal U-turn whilst he wasn't on no emergency.
Right?
Yeah, you got a point, though.
You got a point. Best character all time, Barney Fife.
Well, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
The best
sidekick.
Best sidekick. Look at him. Those faces.
Blowed up way out of proportion. I think you better write yourself a ticket. Then we'll
he's got a face.
I'm just trying to save us both a lot of embarrassment.
Can you imagine the policeman writing himself a ticket
in front of a mob?
The more you fuss about it, the bigger it's getting.
Andy, make him give himself a ticket.
Stay out of this, Gomer.
You're gonna have a riot here in Mayberry.
Look at Andy. Stay out of this, Gomer.
Write out the ticket.
Andy, you're kidding.
Barney, please write out the ticket. Folks, come back now.
I know you guys are enjoying this.
Right, I'll write it out. All right, all right. You make a fool out of me because some boob.
Boob! He's calling me nice.
Can't say that on the radio.
Can't say the T word, but you can say boob.
Right.
Look at him. Oh, that is a classic.
Great bit.
Thank you, Bulldog Nation member Ryan, for giving us that.
Citizens arrest. How can be repaired?
Now I want to share something with you. I got to find this because this guy gave me the information. God, I got to find it. Where is it? He told me about the...
What is this? Texting all of a sudden?
Jim
not
from
real
Verona.
Text,
the Henry character. The Henry character is Jay Santos, who is the sub-commander in the Citizens Auxiliary Police.
Thank you. That's a funny bit.
The
man,
sub-commander. I want to know what the official title of this Jack Wagon Hernandez guy, you know, I'm the captain of the sub-commander Citizens Auxiliary Police of Sanford in this community. And I will guarantee you, this guy has police magazines. He watches Cops. I guarantee you that his buddies come over and they act like that they're really cool. And he buys online handcuffs and army knives and camouflage stuff. I mean, living in his mother's basement.
And he's ready to march on Washington with you.
No! Insulted me. That's as bad as calling me a boob.
Boob.
We come back, more radio superbity on Real Talk 1160. Eric Deters, the Bulldog on Real Talk 1160. Pour a little sugar on it. My show and tell, which I'll have to describe for those listening, but it'll be on the video cast, is a photograph that I took last night of my granddaughter Riley, my wife holding her outside the rehearsal. Look at that little face on her. Look at how cute she is. Here, I'll show it to you. You see that, TC?
Well, look at her.
Is she not the cutest little thing?
That smile.
That's the face that she makes. She smiles at it. She's like, okay, what do you want?
She's photogenic.
She's not going to want. I'm going to work like five more jobs to give my grandchildren everything they want.
She looks like a heartbreaker in training.
Yeah, she is. She's a friendly little girl. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the American jury, the feel-good song today. I didn't want to be a sap. I've already given that public Irish blessing, a little sappy. I want to give it some passion. This is for Charlie Ann and Chad on their wedding night. Their wedding day. A classic from Elvis. Burning love. May it never burn out. God, I love this song.
My brain is flaming.
Brain is flaming. Don't know which way to go. I love those lyrics. Your voice lifts me high like a sweet song of a choir.
And I was just thinking, they never should have made a Fat Elvis stamp.
Nah. Don't eat Fat Elvis. Don't you wish you looked like young Elvis?
Oh,
thank you. Thank you very much.
Oh, sound like young Elvis.
Yeah, I got Aunt Margaret. And everybody else.
Yeah, there's a cool one.
That's a good one on the old stamp. Your kisses lift me high. Sweet song of a choir. Light my morning. That's some good lyrics. Yeah. Who wrote the lyrics of that song?
I don't know.
You know, he was only 42 when he died?
Wow.
That's messed up.
Maybe
he looked
Mac
like
Davis
he was 50.
Maybe it was Mac Davis, I'm guessing. I don't know. No, he wrote In the Ghetto.
Wrote In the Ghetto?
I don't know who wrote that one. Burning Love.
You know, I wonder. You know, Maxim Magazine made Elvis the number one man of all time, guy's man, because he was a fat guy that could get chicks and he died on the throne. Hard to breathe. Oh, heave.
And just think of how many careers were launched because of Elvis. How many Elvis impersonators are there
in
Vegas?
Oh, my gosh.
These guys would be out of work if it weren't for this guy.
Graceland. 3,000 Miles to Graceland is a great movie.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Kevin Costner and Kurt Russell
all
play
the Elvises,
bank robbers, Elvises. Great movie. There's Elvis
movie.
Meeting Nixon. How fun is it that
he was a
agent, federal agent. Thank you, Richard Nixon. Thank you, Mr. President. I want to be an agent. Hunka, hunka, burning love. Ladies and gentlemen, the American jury, I hope you have a hunka, hunka, burning love somewhere. Hunka, hunka, burning. God, that's good stuff, man.
That's a great song. You going to play that tonight? Are they going to play that at the reception?
I don't know. You know, they had, you're supposed to pick out a song for the father. This is funny. Father, and my daughter said, you know, do you want to get a song and you want to, like, practice a dance? You know, like those YouTube
Butterfly
videos.
All,
and I'm thinking, man, that's not me, man. I'm not going to be a, you know, choreograph some big dance. Plus, I don't have time. So I said, well, let's come up. So we're figuring out. And you know the song we're going to use?
Butterfly Kisses.
Nope. The theme song from Juno. Remember that little song with it where the boy and the girl play their guitar and they sing that song to each other?
No, I'm not.
It's a cute little song.
Is it? All right.
And I told her, I said, we can dance an Irish jig to it.
Now, there you go. There you go.
We did practice a few steps with it, but it's a low-key song.
Yeah.
Juno. And it's kind of appropriate because you know about the Juno, you know, it was about her pregnancy.
Oh, that's right.
Remember
okay,
about
yeah,
the Beckner
right.
pregnancy? You know, that's a great movie. Have you seen it?
No, I've not seen it. I remember hearing really good things about it.
Jacob's shaking his head. Juno is about, you know, a young girl that gets pregnant, and she has to decide what to do. She chooses not to get an abortion. She decides to have the baby. She's going to give it up to this couple who's dysfunctional. But she's just a tough little kid.
Yeah.
Tough little – and the dad's funny, man. I forget that character that plays the dad. But you know what? Life is hard.
Yes.
And things happen. But the reality of – you know, the way I look at it is, and I've been the recipient of this from my parents. You know what? Life is hard. It's life for all of us. But when the chips are down and something happens to you, there's a great comfort of the warm blanket of family and friendship that you can always count on and should be able to count on. I think everybody in tough times has to have somebody they can turn to. I think that's one of the tragedies of these teenage suicides over bullying and whatnot. Obviously, there's such great despair. They see no hope and nobody to turn to. But, you know, things happen. I mean, you get fired from a job, you foreclosure, you get financial problems, you have family problems, you got teenage pregnancy. I can tell you right now, folks, the prescription drug and illegal drug issue in this country and in this community is bad. Spoke at the rehearsal dinner last night, I spoke to a ICU nurse, and this one family, man, two family members, same time, heroin.
Wow.
But every family faces trials and tribulations of some kind. And if you don't have family to be there for you or friends to be there for you unconditionally, because let's face it, folks, if you say, well, I'm going to love you and support you if you do X, Y, Z. Now, it doesn't mean that as a parent, for example, you don't want them to do X, Y, Z.
Yeah.
But when they don't do X, Y, Z, you're going to say, well, because you didn't do it the way I want to do it, then the hell with you. Man, you can't do that. I know I've done things that my, you know, my parents could have said, well, hell with you because you did that, and they didn't do that to me.
I think we all do.
We all do. You know? But isn't it nice to have that safe harbor of family and friendship when something happens that you need that? Because I don't care who you are, what socioeconomic group you're in, you cannot protect your family from everything that's going to come that way, which is what most fathers want to do. You know, for example, I use this as an example. Paul McCartney, rich, famous. He spent every single day of his life with Linda, but one. Every night together, but one. He could not save her from cancer.
Yeah.
You know, if Paul McCartney can't save his wife from cancer,
yeah.
You know, you can't, you know, so there's always those trial and tribulations. And, you know, I very publicly, you know, Charlie Ann went through that, you know, a pregnancy, an unwedded pregnancy. But you know what? Look at little Riley. And by the way, it's kind of interesting. I got so many other friends who situations I know that have had that situation. And I find it remarkable how wonderful the kids are. In other words, I know so many kids that are a product of that are just good kids. In other words, it works out.
Yeah.
It works out. You know what I mean? And, you know, in your lucky, you know, one of the sad things is, and this is a big difference, she's fortunate that she has us.
Right.
I mean, if you are living in a low-income socioeconomic situation and you get pregnant and you don't have the support, that's bad. And the situation is totally different.
Right. Oh, yeah. Completely.
Completely different. I think about that all the time. You know, if my daughter didn't have me and, you know, everything, you know, she could be in a totally different situation.
Yeah.
Of course, she knows that, and she's very grateful to it. But I'm looking forward to the wedding. The one thing I'm not looking forward to, TC, is I don't get this. Why does there have to be hours of pre-ceremony pictures?
Oh, yeah. You got to do it before everybody starts sweating all over their tux. That's why. Take the pictures now while everybody's hair is in place and before anybody starts sweating. are getting really, you know, and especially if you've got like little kids that are in the wedding before they start getting real antsy. You got to do that right away and get it over with.
Here's one thing that I know that's going to happen. First of all, this is pretty cool because Riley is 10 months old.
Yeah.
I am carrying Riley down the aisle while I'm walking Charlie Ann down the aisle.
Nice.
I will be sobbing.
Uh-oh. And they're going to be playing Butterfly Kisses.
I mean, I just know. Jacob said, I'll be filming it.
Hey, you know what? Now, that's
Now, I hope I don't, but I'm just a big old softy, and I mean, I'm going to be carrying my granddaughter in one arm, daughter in the other. Oh,
it's going to happen.
Kicking the old heart. We come back, we'll wrap this show up of Radio Superbity on Real Talk 1160.
Remember, UC Bearcat Baseball, tomorrow afternoon, Steve Jarnicki calls the game, first pitch at 1 o'clock, right here at Real Talk 1160. And now, back to the Bulldog.
Eric Deters, the Bulldog on Real Talk 1160. Thank you for all your kind text messages. I have to honor somebody, a great Cincinnati, rest in peace, Manuel Meyerson, age 90, great developer and philanthropist. The Meyerson name is all over the place in Cincinnati. You know what? One of the great things, TC, about getting filthy rich is you can donate a lot of money.
I wouldn't know.
For great causes. I can't don't either. But one day I hope I am.
I just get filthy.
I love that. I love that. You know, today is the day that Patrick Henry gave that great speech, Give Me Liberty or Give Me Death. And I play it all the time, and I think I played it yesterday, so I'm not going to play it again today. But, you know, Patrick Henry was discussing the idea that there had to be great sacrifices, and that liberty was more important than life itself. I mean, that was the whole point of what he was trying to say. And at the time that he gave this speech in 1775, there was already shots being fired in Lexington, Concord, Bunker Hill. Do you realize that? Lexington, Concord, Bunker Hill all began before the Declaration of Independence. And when he says we are already in the field, it's what he meant. It's what he meant. And many thought it was treason. And I find it amusing. I really do. I find it amusing that we have laws in place. And you've got to be really careful of what you say, because you, as a citizen of the United States, might have some federal marshals or federal Secret Service or CIA haul us away and take us off to Gitmo. John Adams was a one-term president. He was a one-term president for two primary reasons. One, he refused to go to war, which was a good thing. We were not in a position to fight another war with Britain or France. And number two, he passed a law called the Alien and Sedition Acts. And that law basically made it a crime to speak out against the government and public officials. It was repealed, of course, but the ripple effect of that destroyed Adams' presidency. Destroyed it. Now, we in this country have free speech. We're allowed to speak out. But I find it amusing that no one in this country, and maybe there are a few people, I am, that we do not realize that the state of our affairs are in such a disarray that the only way that they can be improved is through a complete radical change of the way we do business. The gentleman who is marrying my daughter tonight, Steve Hoffman, is a great guy. He is a big-time Democrat. If he isn't still, he's been the chairman of the local political party over in Northern Kentucky. But he's a friend, and he's a good guy. And he was talking to me yesterday about that he thinks the economy is improving. And I said, Steve, let me tell you something. And there's two, if you studied economics in school, there was general economics. But then there was also, especially if you majored in economics, there was macroeconomics and microeconomics. Macroeconomics deals with those issues like jobs and so forth and so on. And microeconomics deals with those things such as the Federal Reserve and you know, behind-the-scenes economics, if you would. Let me tell you something, folks. Both the macroeconomic and the microeconomic in this nation does not look good, particularly when you're dealing with the debt in this country. The trillions of dollars of debt, $16 trillion and counting. Obama submitting a $1.3 trillion budget. The Congressional Budget Office saying in 10 or 20 years, we're talking about $27 million in debt. Cannot be sustained. Cannot be sustained. So on the anniversary of Patrick Henry's speech, I want everybody to think about the way your life is right now. The way your life is right now. Is it better for America to go off the proverbial cliff or for you to make sacrifices to keep it from going off the cliff? And I think collectively, senior citizens, the hardworking taxpayers, everybody in this country that loves this country should be and hopefully is willing to make some sacrifices, because it's the only way we're going to save this great country. Now, if you thought I was going to end the Friday show on that, you're crazy. You got to get a microphone there, Mark. Joining me in the studio is some, you got to turn around. You want to go over there? You got to go over there. You know what? There's nothing worse than when you bring a rookie in the studio. You know what I'm talking about, TC?
I know.
Is there anything worse than a rookie in the studio?
We'll learn him.
Mark Epley, who is a lawyer in my office, who wants to be in a radio business.
Why?
Is that not true?
Absolutely, Bulldog.
He likes the Bulldog, and he wants to be a Bulldog. They look kind of like a Bulldog. He's kind of a hefty guy. But anyway, Mark has joined my law. And Mark, aren't you excited the fact that we're going to have a law office right down the hall from here?
Do your radio show and then get to business, sir.
How you like that? You get to do law and radio all at the same time. By the way, I got an update for the ladies and gentlemen in the American jury and Bulldog Nation and UTC. This is for everybody.
Okay.
I mean, this is exciting stuff that I'm about ready to announce. I had a telephone conference yesterday with a producer of a television show.
Really?
That is very, very national. Very, very interested in me in a television show.
Bulldog's Gone Wild.
Probably not until September, when some of these things could take place, as far as it takes forever. As this guy explained, it takes years for something to actually happen.
Yeah.
But had a very good conversation. Furthermore, my agent is actually going to be having the conversation with some big-time heavyweights in radio syndication, and they are excited about it. Mm. My dream, folks, that I could do a national radio syndication show right here, Real Talk 1160, walk down the hall and still practice law. How cool would that be?
That's a heck of a dream.
And be on television.
Yeah, and be president.
Thank you for reminding me of the other dream.
And be a Supreme Court judge in Kentucky.
And be a Supreme. You know what? Ambition.
Drive race cars.
Ambition. I don't have that dream.
Oh, okay.
Ambition is a terrible thing. Do you think I have enough dreams?
No, I think you do. You have enough to keep you entertained for a while. Hey, yeah.
By the way, ladies and gentlemen, the American jury, it's a true story. I'm being totally honest. There are days when I say I want to say the hell with all of it, and I just like want to have
away.
Peace. You know, I want to be like to just like work a normal job, come home and enjoy the UK Wildcats, and then go to bed by 11. You know what I'm saying?
Wouldn't that be nice? Those days are gone forever.
By the way, isn't it true, folks? There's not a normal life for anybody in America anymore, is there?
No.
What's normal? You got a normal life?
I don't know. How do you classify normal?
Well, I tell you what. I would say that the normal life that we grew up with, that we witnessed,
right,
that what we thought is normal is gone.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, definitely.
Don't you agree, Mark?
There is no normalcy in this society anymore, for sure.
Yeah. Did you grow up with a picket fence and all that good stuff?
No, I did not.
Oh, Jim. Well, we're going to save it. The childhood of Mark Epley, the obstacles that he had to overcome.
The big difference, when we were kids, we were inundated with sitcoms. Every night it was Happy Days one night.
I loved Happy Days.
Yeah, and then you had Good Times.
Good
All
Times.
In the Family.
Laverne and Shirley.
Now it's all reality shows.
That's true.
Or Idol, you know.
Idol. This is the Bulldog. Every dog has their day. I hope tomorrow is yours. Thank you for tuning in all week. Radio Superbity will be back Monday. Thank you for all the good wishes to my daughter. I'm sure they'll have burning love to their dying day, which hopefully is a long, long, long time on Real Talk 1160.
Yeah.